Welcome to the course, Formal Language and Automata Theory. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about various types of Turing machines. So till now, we discussed various concepts about Turing machine. So that is history, introduction, model, formal definition, instantaneous description, acceptance of strings and languages by Turing machine, then recursively enumerable language, then recursive language, then closure properties of recursive and recursively enumerable languages, then design of Turing machine for languages. So till now, all these topics are covered. So now we will move to other interesting topic related to Turing machine only. So that is types of Turing machines. So actually this topic was included in fifth unit, first part. So in this lecture, here we will cover types of Turing machine, followed by Turing machine and halting also. Next, further coming classes, we will start the concept of undecidability. So here undecidability, the concept several times we are reviewing. A problem have no algorithm, then that problem is said to be undecidable or unsolvable. Then for regular languages, for context-free languages, we discussed some of the undecidable questions or problems. So by considering those, here again Turing machine undecidability concepts also discussed here. Then finally, we have one post correspondence problem. This is also an undecidable problem. Then here one question is there. They will give some set of lists with set of integers. So whether these lists have post correspondence solution or not. Here one small problem, this is a very interesting problem. Then modification of post correspondence, we have modified post correspondence problem. Then we will see later some other undecidable problems. This counter machine also we will cover under one of the type of Turing machine. So now let us move to our actual topic. So here, under types, also called as variations, also called as modifications of Turing machine. So in examination, if you will get theory question, there may be chance of getting question on this. They will ask types of Turing machines, or specifically some particular names are given. You can explain about so and so type of Turing machine, or these concepts also somewhat important. If you will get some short answers type or B, C like. So Chert's hypothesis, that also we'll cover, very small topic. Then counter machine or offline Turing machine. This is also one kind of Turing machine. Then composite and iterated Turing machine. Then Turing machine and halting. So all these, whatever the topics we are going to cover broadly comes under the category of types or variations or modifications of Turing machine. Now let us see the first category, types of Turing machines. So majorly, various types of Turing machines are given below. The first one is Turing machine with two-way infinite tape. But all these types, the base model is same as our basic Turing machine. With some modifications, with some enhancements, you will get various types of Turing machines. The first one is Turing machines with two-way infinite tape. Then the second one is multi-tape Turing machine. Then third one is multi-head Turing machine. Then the fourth one is Turing machine with two-dimensional tape. Then the fifth one is non-deterministic Turing machine. So here you can observe, the name itself clearly gives the variation. First, Turing machine with two-way infinite tape. Anyway, the Turing tape is infinite, but both ways it has to be extended infinitely. Then that is called as two-way infinite tape. Then multi-tape Turing machine. Here you can see the name itself, multi-tape, more than one tape. In the basic model of Turing machine, we have only one tape. But if it contains more than one tape, then that is called as multi-tape Turing machine. Then multi-head Turing machine means with the basic model with one Turing machine, more than one read or write header, then that is called as multi-head Turing machine. Then Turing machines with two-dimensional tape. So normally we will consider our Turing machine with one dimensional tape only. So whenever the dimensionality is increased, one dimensional to two dimensional or more than two, then that is multidimensional. Then the Turing machine is called as Turing machine with two dimensional, multidimensional tape. Only tape dimension is changed. Then non-deterministic Turing machine. Then the concept of non-determinism we discussed in finite automaton, in pushdown automaton also, then in Turing machine also. So this is similar to non-deterministic finite automaton. Why? Because Turing machine is essentially a finite automaton. So here you can observe one commonality among all these types. It is observed that computationally all these types of Turing machines are equally powerful. The computational power of all these types of Turing machines have the same. That means one type can compute the same that other can do. But however, where all these five are differ with respect to efficiency of computation. So the efficiency of computation may vary one type to other type. So these are all the similarities and differences among various types of Turing machines. Now we will see one by one Turing machine with the diagrammatic representation followed by some description. So the first one, Turing machine with two-way infinite tape. So here you can observe, this looks like our basic model of Turing machine only. But the only thing is that Turing tape should be extended in both directions infinitely, towards left and towards right. But in the basic model also, we have taken same diagram only. But in the model of Turing machine, there we restricted the left hand. Then right hand is open to extend infinitely. So here, a two-way infinite tape Turing machine is a Turing machine with its input tape infinite in both directions. So that is left and right. The other components being the same as that of the basic model. Then the operation, so all the components description, everything same. So here the tape is extended towards left hand by including blank symbol, then towards right hand by including blank symbols. This is the model of Turing machine with a two-way infinite tape. Then some aspects about this two-way infinite tape Turing machine. Here we have one theorem. So whenever we have one-way Turing machine, let us say M naught, can be simulated by a two-way infinite Turing machine, TM, let us say MT. That means whenever we have one-way Turing machine, that is our basic Turing machine. So then that can be simulated by a two-way infinite tape Turing machine, let us say MT. So this is one theorem, that is equivalence of one-way to two-way infinite tape Turing machine. So here MT, that is the two-way infinite tape Turing machine, puts a hash symbol, which is called as the end marker, to the left of the leftmost non-blank and moves it head right and simulates M naught. That is one-way infinite tape Turing machine. Even in finite automata also, the movement of read-write head will be in left direction and right direction. But that is restricted towards right only by keeping the end markers. One is at left end and another one is at right end. But then in the Turing machine, we are restricting the left end by keeping the hash symbol. That right end is open. So then if MT, that is the two-way infinite tape Turing machine, reads again a hash symbol, then it halts, rejecting the input. As that means M naught tries to move off the left end of the tape. So whenever the end marker finds, then MT halts by rejecting the input. So this is one theorem followed by with some explanation. So now here move to the second type of Turing machine, which is called as multi-tape Turing machine. Here you can see the name itself gives. So only instead of one tape, here more than one tape is included. So that is called as multi-tape. If you can see the diagram, this is the model of a multi-tape Turing machine. Only one finite control. Then see here we have tape one, tape two, and so on, n tapes are there. So whenever we have multi-tapes are there, automatically for each tape, one separate read-write header is included. Now you can see for tape one, this is one read-write header. Then for tape two, this is read-write header. Then and so on, tape n, this is read-write header, separate read or write headers. So now here you can observe, in multi-tape Turing machine, except the primary tape, remaining all are stored with blank symbol. Then the primary tape or tape one stores input symbols followed by blank symbols towards left and right hand. So now see, this is kind of Turing machine that have one finite control and more than one tape, each with its own read or write header. So this is a model or block diagram of multi-tape Turing machine. Now we can see some points related to this multi-tape Turing machine. So the set of states includes an initial state and some accepting state. Initially, the input, a finite sequence of input symbols, is placed on the first tape. Just now we mentioned all other cells of all tapes hold blank symbol. Then the finite control is in the initial state by default. The head of the first tape is at the left end of the input. That means leftmost input symbol where it is stored. Then all other tape heads are at some arbitrary cell, not at the leftmost cell. Only in the first tape, read-write header will be placed at the leftmost cell. Then all other tape heads are at some arbitrary cell. Since tapes other than the first tape are completely contains blank symbols, that means it doesn't matter where the head is placed initially. So all cells of these tapes look the same other than the first tape. So these are all some of the aspects initially. Then while considering the moves or transitions in multi-tape Turing machine, it depends on the state and the symbol scanned by each of the tape header. In one move, the multi-tape Turing machine does the following. First, what it has to do, the control enters a new state, which could be the same as the previous state sometimes. Then on each tape, a new tape symbol is written on the cell scanned. So whenever a cell is scanned, then the new tape symbol is written on that cell. So any of these symbols may be same as the symbols previously there. In the design of Turing machine, we already seen. So sometimes we are skipping, means the same symbol is replaced with same, then it moves towards left or right. So that possibility is also there. Then each of the tape head makes a move, which can be either left, right, or stationary. This is one more direction. Stationary means no movement. It will be in the same cell. The heads move independently. So different heads may move in different directions. There is no restriction on movement of read or write headers, one tape to other tape. And some may not move at all. That means, yes, stationary. That means no movement. So in one move in multi-tape Turing machine, depends on the following aspects. Then there is one theorem for multi-tape Turing machine. So the theorem statement is, a multi-tape Turing machine can be simulated by a single-tape Turing machine. But reverse is not true here. Then coming to the third type of Turing machine, which is called as multi-head Turing machine. Here the name itself gives multi-head. That means with one Turing tape, more than one head. So a multi-head Turing machine is a single-tape Turing machine having k heads, reading symbols on the same tape. In one step, all the heads sense the scanned symbols and move or write independently. Now you can see the model or block diagram of multi-head Turing machine. Here see only one finite control, then one infinite Turing tape. Now you can see each input is scanned with one header. So now head one means read or write header one, then read or write header two, and so on, read or write header k. So that is the multi-head Turing machine. One tape, then multi-heads. That means let us say k heads. Then respective heads may read the respective positioned symbols. Then it can be easily seen that this type of Turing machines are as powerful as one tape Turing machine. Why? Because at a time multitasking is performed here. Now here also one theorem is there related to this one. A multi-head Turing machine M can be simulated by a single tape Turing machine, let us say M dash. Then reverse is not true here. This is the theorem related to multi-head Turing machine. Then coming to fourth type of Turing machine, Turing machines with the two dimensional tapes, that means more than one dimensional. Here we will consider one example of two dimensional, then multi-dimensional also, more than two dimensional. So this is a kind of Turing machine that have one finite control, then one read or write header, then one two-dimensional tape, that is 2D tape. The tape has the top end and the left end, but extends indefinitely to the right and down also. Here you can see now the movement is top end, left end, then right and down. So here you can see the movement is in four directions. So it is divided into rows of small squares. Now, for any Turing machine of this type, there is a Turing machine with one dimensional tape, that is our basic Turing machine model, that is equally powerful. That is, the former can be simulated by the latter. That means two dimensional is simulated with one dimensional, like and so on. So to simulate a two dimensional tape with a one dimensional tape, first what we have to do, we map the squares of the two dimensional tape to those of one dimensional tape diagonally, as shown in the following table. So we'll consider diagonal mapping. Now you can see this diagram shows example of a two dimensional tape, so which can be divided into cells with the rows and column combinations. So here the row and column are added with some special symbols like blank symbol, then all other rows and columns are filled with the values or symbols of the input with diagonally. Now you can see here the numbers indicate correspondence of squares in the two tapes. So for example, square I of the two dimensional tape is mapped to square I of one dimensional tape. So now the correspondence here in two dimensional, the corresponding square is I, then in one dimensional, the corresponding square is I. So this should be matched. Similarly, suppose here we use H and V are symbols which are not in tape alphabet, and they are used to mark the left and the top end of the tape. So H is the left and V is the top end. Here you can see this is the left. Now this is the top end. So this is left. Now this is top end. So respectively, this is the example of two-dimensional tape and the data, how this can be stored. Now you can see, we'll compare with the two-dimensional tape with one-dimensional tape. So this is the diagram, which is example of one-dimensional tape. One-dimensional tape means our normal basic model Turing tape. So here you can observe, here the tape is divided into number of cells. Each cell holds one symbol at a time, then all the symbols are included with the combination of the previous values V and H also. Here V and H combinations are there. Why? Because this has to match with two-dimensional tape. So the head of a two-dimensional tape moves one square up, one square down, one square left, or one square right. Here you can see four directions. In our basic model of Turing machine, we have only two directions, either left or right. Now here extra up and down, total four directions are there. Now some Turing machines with one dimensional tape can simulate every move of a Turing machine with one two dimensional tape. So hence they are at least as powerful as the Turing machines with a two dimensional tape. Then Turing machines with a two-dimensional tape obviously can simulate Turing machine with one-dimensional tape. Latter depends on the latter. So it can be said that they are equally powerful. So now another example of two-dimensional tape. Here you can see multi-dimensional tape, that is cube. The tape is represented in the form of cubical, so more than two-dimensional. Now this is multi-dimensional tape example, which contains one read-or-write header. So in multi-dimensional tape Turing machine, the head moves one square up, one square down, one square left, or one square right. All four directions so are possible in multi-dimensional Turing machine. Then coming to the last type of Turing machine, non-deterministic Turing machine. So which is looks like non-deterministic finite automaton. In non-deterministic finite automaton, from a state on one input, it will be in several next states with the same input. That is possible in non-deterministic. And even with empty string, that is with null, so it moves. So these are all allowed in non-deterministic finite automaton. Whereas deterministic, these are all not allowed. So this looks like non-deterministic finite automaton. At any state, it is in, and for the tape symbol, it is reading. Can take any action, selecting from a set of specified actions, rather than taking one definite predetermined. That's why it is non-deterministic. Even in the same situation, it may take different actions at different times. Here, an action means the combination of writing a symbol on the tape, moving the tape head and going to the next state, like transitions. So for example, here from a state on a tape symbol. So several possibilities, several next moves. That's why this is non-determinism. So now, a non-deterministic Turing machine is as powerful as deterministic Turing machine. Thus, these variations in Turing machines gives various types of Turing machines. Now, there is one theorem related to this non-deterministic Turing machine. Any language accepted by a non-deterministic Turing machine, which is also accepted by some deterministic Turing machine. Not all deterministic Turing machines, some deterministic Turing machines. This is the theorem, equivalence of non-deterministic to deterministic. But here we don't have the conversion procedures for non-deterministic to deterministic, like non-deterministic finite automata to deterministic finite automata. Then coming to the formal definition of non-deterministic Turing machine, which is same as Turing machine. Here the only difference we can observe, while defining delta, there only it changes, remaining all are same. So a non-deterministic Turing machine M is a seven tuple denoted by M equal to Q sigma tau delta Q naught blank F, where Q is non-empty set of states, sigma is input alphabet, then tau is tape alphabet, then Q naught is initial or start state, then B is in tau, which is a blank symbol, then F is a subset of Q, that is set of accepting or final states, then delta is mapping function or transition function, so which is mapping from, here you can see the difference. Q cross tau to Q cross tau cross L comma R in normal Turing machine. But here one more extra direction is added, that is S. Here S is the movement of read or write header towards stationary. That means no movement, stable. Whereas L means as usual, movement of the read write header towards left. Then the movement of read or write header towards right. So that is the difference here. In the mapping, so one more direction is added, that is stationary, denoted by S, remaining all are same as our basic Turing machine. Then there are some limitations of Turing machines. So Turing machine is a model which can solve any problem which has some algorithm, but not all the problems can be solved by the Turing machine. So there are some problems which cannot be solved by a Turing machine, so which are called as undecidable problems. So one of such example is the halting problem, can be stated as follows. The statement of Turing machine halting problem. See, sometimes you will get a question on this, explain about the Turing machine halting problem. So the statement is, it is not possible to determine whether a Turing machine will ever halt on particular input. That means on all inputs, it can't be halted. So such a problem is called as undecidable or unsolvable problem. So therefore, the Turing machine halting problem is undecidable or unsolvable. So this is the statement of Turing machine halting problem. Then other limitations, there are some problems that are not solvable by Turing machine. So which are called as, what are the problems that can't be solved with a Turing machine? That is called as unsolvable or undecidable problem about Turing machine. So the following are some of the problems which are not solvable by the Turing machine. So those are called as unsolvable. The first one is deciding whether two context-free grammars are equivalent. So this is undecidable or unsolvable using Turing machine. All these problems are not solvable with the Turing machine, so which are called as undecidable or unsolvable problems. Then the second one, whether a given program, any program, will loop forever on a particular input. This is also undecidable. Then if two contextual grammars say G1 and G2 are given, then the intersection of these two contextual grammars is empty. So L of G1 intersection L of, this is G2, L of G1 intersection L of G2 equal to 5. This is also undecidable. We can't determine. Then the fourth one, whether the language accepted by Turing machine is empty. This is also unsolvable or undecidable. So these are some of the problems related to Turing machine which are unsolvable or undecidable. So here it is not possible for a Turing machine to answer yes or no for above problems. So hence these problems are unsolvable by Turing machine. These are all some of the limitations of Turing machine. Then coming to our next variation in Turing machine, Church hypothesis, also called as Church-Turing thesis. So this is one approach related to Turing machine. The statement of this approach is, which is called as theorem, the class of effectively computable functions. So you have one set of class which are effectively computing using computable functions. So can be identified with the class of recursive functions. This is known as Church hypothesis or Church-Turing thesis. So any function that is being computed by a Turing machine is called as computable function. After this concept, we'll discuss about computable functions, then construction of Turing machine for computable functions. Any function that is being constructed by a Turing machine, so then that is called as computable function. So those can be identified with class of recursive functions. This approach is called as Church hypothesis or Church-Turing thesis. So now here you can see what are the class of computable functions. So the class of computable functions are given below. You can take any elementary function which is computable. Each elementary function, a basic function, is a computable. Then if a function f is computable, and if another function g can be obtained by applying an elementary operations to f, then g is also computable. Then a function is computable if and only if it can be obtained by using the above rules 1 and 2. So this definition is somewhat similar to recursive definition of regular expressions. So regular expressions, we have defined some set of rules. Then by repeating all the rules by once or several times, what are the applications you will get? Those are all only the regular expression. Like the class of computable functions also, here two rules are given. Each elementary function is computable. Then if a function f is computable and if another function g can be obtained by applying an elementary operation to f, then g is also computable. Then by repeating the above rules 1 and 2, whatever the results we obtain, those are all only computable. These are all the class of computable functions. So then coming to our next variation of Turing machine, counter machine or offline Turing machine. So this is also one kind of Turing machine actually. So now what is counter machine or offline Turing machine, which is also called as a multi-stack Turing machine. Here you can see the name itself gives multi-stack Turing machine. Now here the counter machines which are offline Turing machine or multi-stack Turing machines whose storage steps are semi-infinite, not fully infinite, semi-infinite, and whose step alphabets contains only two special symbols called as Z and B, which are called as blank and initial symbol. Now you can see the model of offline or counter machine or multi-stack Turing machine, which consisting of one finite control, then somewhat similar to multi-tape Turing machine. More than one tape is there. But in multi-tape, so one is a fixed tape. Here you can see the primary tape, which can be represented on top. So it is restricted with the finite length by including two end markers. That is, one is at left end, another one is at right end. Then in between, we have the input. The input only you can read, we can't write. So that's why it contains only read-only input. So this is a finite tape. Then other tapes represented on the bottom of the finite control. So here we have semi-infinite tape 1 and semi-infinite tape 2 and so on, semi-infinite tape K. Here you can see why you are calling it as semi-infinite. The left end is fixed, then right end is open, extended infinitely. So now these tapes lengths are denoted by D1, that is distance, then D2 for a particular tape like. So all these semi-infinite tapes, left cell consisting of Z, that is the initial symbol, then all are filled with blank symbols. Now let us see some functionality about this type of Turing machine, or counter machine, or offline Turing machine. The symbol Z, which serves as bottom of stack marker. So here we'll use the concept of stack, that is PDE. So appears initially on the cell scanned by the tape head and may never appear on any other cell. Z appears only in one cell. So initially, then power of the compute counter machine, power or the importance of counter machine. So every language accepted by a counter machine, which is called as recursively enumerable language. So if you have a counter machine Turing machine, if any language that is accepted by this counter machine, then the language is called as recursively enumerable language. Then every language accepted by one counter machine, so is a context-free language with only one counter machine. So one counter machine is a special class of one stack machine. So that is pushdown automaton. So if any language accepted with only single counter machine, then that language is called as context-free language. Then this is the special case of one stack machine, that is pushdown automaton. Then here also we have some theorems related to counter machine or offline Turing machines. Theorem one is every recursively enumerable language is accepted by three counter machine. Then every recursively enumerable language is also accepted by a two counter machine. So by default one counter machine, then also with the two counter machine and three counter machine, the recursively enumerable languages are accepted. These are all the theorems related to counter machines or offline Turing machine. So then coming to other variation or modification of Turing machine, composite and iterated Turing machine. So composite is nothing but a hybrid type combination. Iterated means repetitions. So then how to define these two? To solve a collection of simple programs, it is easy to combine two or more Turing machines by combining two or more Turing machines and get one single Turing machine. So that output of Turing machine forms the input to the next Turing machine and so on. This is called as composite Turing machine. That means one Turing machine output will be considered as input to the next Turing machine. Then next Turing machine output should be considered as the input of next Turing machine and so on. Then by combining all these, so we'll get a single output that is called as a composite Turing machine. Then another way of having combination Turing machine is by applying its own output or input repeatedly. A particular Turing machine input or output that can be repeated. Then this is called as iterated or recursive Turing machine. So these are all the two more variations of Turing machine, composite and iterated Turing machine. That's all about this one. It's very simple. Then the last variation of Turing machine is Turing machines and halting. So here we already discussed the statement of halting problem of Turing machine. So here we will focus more on that. So now here, Turing machine and halting, in general, without otherwise stating so, the following statement. We assume that a Turing machine always halts when it is in accepting state. So this is a proven statement. So whenever the Turing machine is in accepting state, compulsory, every time it halts. If it is not in accepting state, so there may be chances with less possibilities, but it is not always possible to require that a Turing machine halts even if it does not accept. So those languages with Turing machines that do halt eventually, regardless of whether or not they accept, are called recursive. See, here we discussed the two languages. One is recursive and recursively enumerable languages. So recursive language, which gives the both results, that is yes or no, both results, then that is fully decidable. Whereas recursively enumerable language, which gives only the result is yes, irrespective of any input. then this is semi-decidable. So that's why a Turing machine halting may be possible, means it satisfies the concept of recursive language. So for every input, it halts. Even for recursive NM rule, only for some, not for all inputs or strings. That is the difference between recursive and recursive enumerable language. So now same concept is used here. Turing machines that always halt, regardless of whether or not they accept or good model of an algorithm. That means whenever there is an algorithm, means the problem can be solved, means solvable. If an algorithm to solve a problem exists, then we say that the problem is said to be decidable or solvable. So Turing machines that always halt will fall importantly into decidability theory. Always halts. That means decidable, solvable. But only some cases it also means that falls under undecidability theory. Okay, now let us come to summary of this lecture, what we discussed. Here we covered first various types of Turing machines or classifications or categorizations, then other variations or modifications. We discussed about the Church hypothesis or Church Turing thesis, then another variation, counter machine or offline Turing machine, also called as multi-stack Turing machine, then composite and iterated Turing machines, then finally Turing machine and halting. Okay, now I stop here. Next class we'll come up with other new topics.